I've been preparing for this service, there's been one verse, one passage that just won't leave me alone. And I have learned to listen when God places things upon my heart. And it's this passage that says, "In all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God." There is not a single thing that can separate us. Eugene Peterson, who paraphrases Scripture, kind of think, "With God on our side like this, how can we lose? If God didn't hesitate to put everything on the line for us, embracing our condition and exposing himself to the worst by sending his own son, is there anything else he wouldn't gladly and freely do for us? And who would dare tangle with God, messing with one of God's chosen? Who would dare even point a finger? The one who died for us, who was raised to life for us, is in the presence of God at this very moment, sticking up for us. Do you think anyone is going to be able to drive a wedge between us and Christ's love for us? There is no way. Not trouble, not hard times, not hatred, not hunger, not homelessness, not bullying threats, not backstabbing, not even the worst sins listed in Scripture. None of this fazes us because Jesus loves us. I'm absolutely convinced that nothing, living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love." That is good news. Because it is something difficult that brings us together this afternoon. And experts say that absolutely everyone will be touched by a suicide in their lifetime. Every single one of us is going to have suicide touch our lives, whether it is a sibling or a spouse, a child or a coworker, a friend, even a pastor. The stats get worse and worse every year. Every year the suicide rate has increased. And right now, more than 44,000 annually commit suicide. In our country, every 12 minutes, there is a death to suicide. And the segment of our population that is most at risk is middle-aged white men. There are two different approaches at funerals like this. One is to not talk about it at all. The other is to hit it head on. I think that's what we must do, because suicide is a unique grief. It is such a different grief than that of a World War II veteran whose body has finally just given up on them, and at last a merciful difference. For 28 years of ministry, I have walked with families that have had their whole world turned upside down. I've heard statements of pain such as, "This is such a horrible journey." I've heard spouses say, "He's not the man I married. He just wasn't the same." I've heard children say, "Daddy was sick. He really wasn't himself." I hear statements such as, "I never saw it coming," or, "I should have known and been able to do something." And so a death like this leaves us with questions, lots of questions. And the first question is simply, what could I have done to stop it? Why didn't I? Some people who carry the weight of responsibility not right. It is not fair. It is not in our I was 15 years old, and got a phone call from my friend Heather. And Heather's parents had been married, divorced, got remarried to each other, and were in the midst of a divorce for the second time. And she called me, and she was in pain. She was crying. Even at 15, as naive as I was at 15, I thought, sounds like she's in a bad place. She might attempt some kind of self-harm, and so I refused to get off the phone with her. We talked and talked and talked until finally she was laughing and promised me that she wouldn't do anything. When I got to school the next morning, I found out that she had attempted. I was in the hospital. We can look for signs, but most of the time it is out of our control. Sometimes we can't see it at all. One of the illustrations I have shared with our worshiping congregation here was set back in a different time, a time before TV, a time before all of the entertainment that we have, and there were circuses that would come to town. And this took place in a village in France, and there was a man who was in a dark place, dark night of the soul, and there wasn't as much understanding around mental health issues. And he said, "Doctor, I can't go on. There is no joy. I don't know what's going on with me, but I'm in a dark, dark place." And the doctor said, "Oh, come on, man. Snap out of it. You just need to have fun. The circus is coming to town. The great clown, Devereaux, is going to be at the circus. Everyone who sees Devereaux laughs. Is go to the circus and see the great Devereaux." Upon hearing this, the man's chest heaved and he started to cry. He said, "But doctor, I am Devereaux." We can hide so many things. Those people who are closest to us can hide so many things. If we never want to assume the worst, we cannot bear the guilt. An action like this. People hide behind all kinds of things. And sometimes when a person gets to this point, they don't even know what they're doing. I have great respect for one of my colleagues who stood before a gathering of clergy and told a story about a difficult time in his life. His daughter had attempted many times, and they were worried sick about her. And he went into the basement to change a load of laundry. That's the last thing he remembers. The next thing he remembered was his wife screaming, holding him up because he had wrapped an electrical cord around his neck and hung it over a pipe. Dissociative moment. Few of us will ever know what it's like to be in the... When we try and think about it logically, we know that our basic instinct is to preserve our own lives at any cost. And so suicide seems to be the result of an overpowering psychological or even physiological disturbance. A great battle that is going on in one's life. When Sharon and Dennis were in my office, they gave me a resource that had been handed to them, and there was this powerful quote written by a pastor who was delivering a sermon to a family and congregation, much like I am this afternoon. And the quote said this: "Our friend died on his own battlefield. He was killed in action fighting a civil war. He fought against adversaries that were as real to him as his casket is real to us. They were powerful adversaries. They took tolls. They exhausted the last vestiges of his courage and strength. At last, these adversaries overwhelmed him. Only God knows what this child of his suffered in the silent skirmishes that took place in his soul. Only God knows. But our consolation is that God does know and understands. The second question that we're left with in the Christian church is, well, what does the Bible say about suicide? If we are people of the book, shouldn't Christians point to what the Bible has to say? And we know that the Bible says surprisingly little. There are 7 suicides in Scripture, 6 of them in the Hebrew Bible, 1 of them in the New Testament, and that, of course, is Judas. Suicide in the Bible is to prevent capture, embarrassment, persecution. Samson prayed for the strength to make it happen, and it was granted. We know that Genesis says only God is to take a life, but shockingly little in our scriptures. And so the question is, what does the church say? What does the church say about suicide? Matter of fact, what do all 5 of the world's major religions say? This was an interfaith marriage. What do all 5 of the world religions say? Let's start with Judaism and the services up in Minneapolis. The Garrett shared with me just how touched they were with this Jewish community of faith that loved them and really helped walk with them through this. But we know that within Orthodox Jewish, only God has right to take a life. And historically, within Orthodox Judaism, suicides were used proper burial. However, in our age, with a greater understanding and awareness of body chemistry, clinical depression, mental illness, the rules have changed in almost every single progressive Jewish community of faith. Islam depends on which sect you're in. Some sects of Islam say you are doomed to repeat the act for eternity. Other sects, laying down your life for a cause brings eternal reward. But for most mainline brothers and sisters in the Islam faith, progressive communities, like in Judaism, we understand the illness. Buddhism and Hinduism, a cycle of rebirth until the ultimate reality or nirvana. Suicide in this life brings bad karma for the next, but you can, through a long period of death and rebirth and growth, still make it to the ultimate goal. It is a setback, to be sure. Left is Christian church. When I was growing up, many of my Roman Catholic brothers and sisters would say this is an unforgivable sin. And until 1983 in the Roman Catholic Church, it was that, but it wasn't always that way. It wasn't until the 5th century when so many Christians were killing themselves because of persecution, because of disease, that the church had to take a stance to try and keep people alive. But think about the damage that did for all those families. No, our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters today acknowledge that it is not an unforgivable sin, that nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is where we are in the United Methodist Church. We stand with almost all Christians in affirming that passage from Romans, that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Suicide is so often the result of a disease. And just as no one would ever say that if someone died from cancer that they would go to hell, mental illness is a disease. It is not unforgivable. Our God is in the forgiving business, the grace business. Our God is in the business of taking someone who is wrestling with something heavy, who is struggling with any kind of a disease, and making it well. As one of John's dear friends said in eulogizing him up in the Twin Cities, John was in pain. John is in peace. But now John is in peace. And so we have a final question. What can I do? What can I do? And friends, those of you who are here are already doing it. You're already doing it. You are here. for the family. Your love and your support, your hugs, literal and figurative, mean so much. Be here for the Garretts. Be here for their extended family. Let them know that you love them. Don't be afraid to have the conversation, because there are things that need to be told again and again and again. And every time that you allow them to share this, they take one step closer to being in a different place. Don't be afraid to talk about the reality of depression or illness or suicide. We are here. And while we're here, we cling to the promise that none of this phases us, because Jesus loves us. I am absolutely convinced, we heard, that nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and the love of God. So I want to say one final word. It is a word that Sharon and Dennis shared with me in my office. They're doing everything so healthy. They are talking to people because they know they need to talk. And one person said this to them: we have to let him know that we will go on. We will miss him. Always. We will love him. Always. We will.